einen du Sonnenschein und damit dir im Wald allein. Weiter brauch ich nicht so glücklich sein, Wochenend und Sonnenschein.
Greetings, YouTube misfits, miscreants, malcontents, and misanthropes. Claire's here with her coffee. Come on in, grab yourself a cup. We're going to talk about YouTube and YouTubers. I got a lot to cover today, but I do briefly want to mention my beloved University of North Carolina Tar Heel men's basketball team. They lost by 32 points to Florida State yesterday, and it had to be the most disappointing game I have ever seen in my life. And I sat through the season where the Tar Heels only won 8 games. Fortunately, I'm confident that Coach Roy Williams and his staff have by now taken the boys through a vigorous practice, probably with the aid of many evil torture devices. Courage, boys, it can only get better. A good friend of mine here on YouTube, Brett P. Palmer, who does excellent videos, by the way, requested that I do a video concerning polystrate trees, a term you may have heard in a creationist video or two. And let me give you a little background by playing some creationists, and this is from a video by Potholer54 Debunks.
One thing that's been a real problem to evolutionists are what are called polystrate tree trunks.
You see all these sedimentary layers, but jutting through them are these fossilized trees.
The evolutionist only has three choices to solve this problem. One, you can either say that these trees somehow stood upright for millions and millions and millions of years while the dirt layers formed around them, which is impossible because the trees would rot away, right? Two, your only other option is this, that you can say these trees grew through hundreds of feet through solid rock looking for sunlight, which is impossible. Or three, you can say, hey, those trees got deposited that way in a worldwide flood.
Despite the arm waving and shouting by the loquacious Billy Crone, there is another possibility. Billy, like every creationist I've ever listened to, suffers from the misconception that geologists have proposed that all sedimentary rocks were formed very, very slowly, whereas nothing could be farther from the truth. The sediments of the past were laid down in a wide range of depositional environments, just like today, and in some of those environments, sediment can be laid down very quickly, in others very slowly. Polystrate tree fossils are almost invariably associated with coal. As a matter of fact, it's not unusual to find the preserved root systems of polystrate tree stumps actually anchored in coal. And coal is the carbonaceous remnant of deposits that were laid down in vast swamps. Such swamps are common within the floodplains of streams, and floodplains, by definition, often flood. It's not unusual for a single flood event to deposit several feet of sediment, so it's not hard to imagine a tree trunk or a stump being covered by sediment relatively quickly. And I do notice that creationists also underestimate the length of time that a tree trunk or a stump can survive. Actually, they can survive for decades, particularly in environments that impede decay, like in a swamp. Here are some tree trunks in an area that quite clearly isn't a swamp. As a matter of fact, it's the coast of Oregon. This is a ghost forest, and the trees were killed by subsidence as a result of an earthquake, and they're 200 years old. More on polystrate trees later in the video. Now, a number of you have suggested Onision as this week's dim bulb. Unfortunately, I am allergic to Onision, and within 5 seconds of one of his videos coming on, I run screaming from the room. But the good news is, someone has already taken care of Onision this week. Paul C. Hartley, one of the funniest guys I know of.
Good evening, Onision. Now, Greg, I'm going to make this nice and brief, because personally, I don't think that you have a great deal of time left here on YouTube. Over the last few weeks, we've had the drama about Shiloh's memory loss incident, her mental breakdown, her pregnancy, and most recently, her sepsis infection, which have all turned out to be completely fabricated, and each time you've managed to weasel your way out of the ensuing shitstorm and get completely away with it. But More recently, things have got, well, a little more sinister.
Having disemboweled Onision, Paul didn't rest on his laurels this week. He also provided us an hilarious review of Ray Comfort's monstrously stupid video concerning abortion, and I highly recommend that as well, and I will put a link in the info bar.
Ray then spends the next 10 minutes of the documentary playing word games with a bunch of cretins. At least one of these people was one of the half-wits from the beginning of the documentary who thought that Hitler was a communist. So we know that he isn't exactly battling with the titans of academia. Anyone with any common sense will realize that all he has done is construct a strawman argument, throw in a happy helping of appealing to emotion by using terms like baby rather than terms like fetus, embryo, and blastocyst, and the word kill, which of course implies that we are terminating the existence of a fully functional and conscious individual, and not a ball of cells that is no more sentient than a chicken egg, that Ray would most likely have no problem with boiling up in a pan.
I ventured into the minefield of Republican politics again this week by saying snarky things about how Mitt Romney made his money. Of course, a lot of people were talking about that. I didn't use all the material that I had, and what follows is a 2-minute video using some additional material. If you're not interested or you just are tired of the subject, skip ahead 2 minutes in this video. I shan't take offense.
I know what it's like to worry whether you're going to get fired. There were a couple of times I wondered whether I was going to get a pink slip.
It's money that I love. It's money that I love. It's money that I love. It's money that I love.
Mitt Romney says he saved Bain & Company, but he didn't tell you that on the day he took over, he had his predecessor fire hundreds of employees, or that the way the company was rescued was with a federal bailout of $10 million. According to the Globe, Romney's company failed to repay at least $10 million to a failed bank, and the rest of us had to absorb the loss.
You're all fired, including salary and hourly. They walked us out of the building after bringing in guards.
One of the first things that they did was to start cheapening the product.
The quality was going down. It got to the point where we would run out of parts trying to push so many out that sometimes we'd send a machine out without a part on it.
I know what he says. I also know what happened. May be able to create jobs, but I don't think too many more in the United States.
Stripping American businesses of assets, selling everything to the highest bidder, and often killing jobs for big financial rewards.
I mean, he made a bunch of money shutting that place down, chunking it out.
He and Bain investors pocketed about $100 million.
Mitt Romney is now personally worth somewhere over $250 million.
He's going to look out for the money people. He didn't look for us little peons anyway.
If God didn't want them sheep, he would not have made them sheep.
Monday, 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 always Sunday, in the rich man's world.
I promised you a bit more on Paula Straight Trees, and here you go in the first segment of... First nominee today is Doug Sharp, who shares his insights on the Joggins Fossil Cliffs of Nova Scotia.
Welcome to Revolution Against Evolution. I'm your host, Doug Sharp. Okay, this is a place called Joggins, and it's in Nova Scotia. So there's about 18,000 feet of successive layers that these tree trunks extend up through multiple layers of strata.
So
this is an indication that they were buried very rapidly, you know, because if you expect that millions of years of slow deposition would have laid these downs
right.
in little layers of, you know, maybe as an annual layer, the tree trunks would have rotted away before it would have had time to actually fossilize.
I, of course, addressed those particular points earlier in this video. Something that Doug has apparently chosen to ignore is that the tree stumps are found in many different levels of the sedimentary rocks at Joggins Cliffs, and that's significant because, in some cases, the root systems of tree stumps are preserved with their paleo soils, meaning that the trees had grown in the soils, so that it is a little difficult to imagine how all the sediment was deposited in a single flood event. Our next nominee is here to tell us why evolution is a religion.
Hi everyone, my name is Chris Johnson. Today we are going to be discussing about evolution being a religion. The first term I need to define is science, systematic knowledge gained through observation and experimentation. There is no observation and no experimentation that has ever shown us that a dog can come from a non-dog.
Fortunately, no one's ever proposed that that's how evolution happens. And were such an astonishing, dare I say, miraculous event to occur, it would immediately disprove evolution as we understand it.
Or that a dog can produce a non-dog. Now, if you want to believe something non-dog produced a dog, then you're going outside the realm of science.
One certainly would be. But fortunately, no biologists have ever proposed such a thing. I think we've already conceded that point, Chris, so perhaps you should move on.
Evolution is a religion by definition. Again, dogs produce dogs every time.
Could you pick it up a little?
If you want to believe, with a capital B, believe, that long ago and far away something non-dog produced a dog, now you're off into religion, not observable science.
Oh, I'm sorry. Did I break your concentration? Continue.
There are six different types of evolution being taught in the textbooks all over the world.
Whoa! Hold on, Sugar Bridges. I think I've heard this before.
There are six different definitions of evolution. Cosmic evolution is the origin of time, space, and matter. Chemical evolution is the origin of all the elements we have today. Stellar evolution is the origin of the stars and planets. Organic evolution is the origin of life from non-life. Macroevolution is the origin of the major kinds of animals and plants. Then microevolution is simple variations within the kinds.
So Chris Johnson memorizes and then regurgitates old Hovind scripts without the technological razzle-dazzle or production values and with as much personality as the malodorous nuggets that I cleaned out of my fat-ass cat's box this morning. So, in a sense, we have a couple of unofficial nominees this week, Onision and Ray Comfort. I think there's a banana connection there. In any case, Paul C. Hartley has done a wonderful job eviscerating both. Thank you, Paul. That means I don't have to waste my time suffering through one of those god-awful Onision videos. So let's look at our two official nominees, both creationists, and both spewing misinformation that, if you've been around very long, you've heard over and over again. I will give Doug credit for actually going out and looking at some rocks. Chris Johnson, on the other hand, simply sits in a chair and regurgitates whatever he's heard Kent Hovind and Eric Hovind present. His offense is compounded by the fact that he goes out and does his own presentations, droning on in that monotonous, repetitious style. Congratulations, Chris. You are our dim bulb of the week, and I believe this is your second. About this time last year, you garnered your first. It's nice to know that the quality of your presentations hasn't improved.
Everybody, A-S-S-H-O-L-E.
Alrighty, everybody. You have a great week. Bish Peter.